in my 11 years or so now of devoted, true extreme activism, true and extreme are synonyms in this case. Love is extreme or it's not love. Love dives in the way of harm or it's not love. When I gained sanity and began diving into harm's way, the first venue was Chester Elementary School, Christopher Columbus Elementary School in Chester, Pennsylvania, back in 2000-2001. And when within months I saw that the school was the only thing giving these children a chance, that their out-of-school experience was a deadly, toxic stew. I saw that keeping the children out of that stew for as many hours a day as possible was the first order priority. During this process, I began my first hunger strike. After time, heard this question from the pastors. So, in the early stages of my attempt to save the children from this toxic stew, Chester is a 2 mile square, quote, city. Now that anyone with any social, intellectual, emotional, or heart capacity has left. As industry moved out. I did a resource inventory and saw that there were 500 relatively resourceful houses of worship, mostly churches, within about 30 miles of Chester. And Chester is a hub of highways, so transportation to Chester is easy from everywhere and fast. Well, obviously, houses of our Father, houses of God, obviously, they would want to come in and one day a month take over a classroom after school or on a Saturday and create an enriching environment that would save that child or those children from that day of toxic stew. Well, I didn't have the tattoos then. I did not have a reputation of somewhere between a whack job and a radical, so I was able to get meetings with some of the senior pastors in the region at their churches. We'd sit down for 20 minutes or half an hour because it's very important to me to use people's time well. And they'd listen politely. They'd listen. They'd hear what I had to say. And then the same question, meeting after meeting after meeting after meeting, as I had authoritatively brought into their room the dying children of Chester, intellectually, socially, emotionally, and physically, through prison, drug dealing, whatnot. It's probably only now that I'm really getting why I was so absolutely horrified by the question. So start, what do you want us to do? Start, why is that a horrible question? Well, the essence of the horror, the essence of the dead hard indication of that question, I think is clearly illustrated this way to anyone that wants to see it. So if I had come in to any and every one of those pastors, and based on what I saw outside, had said to the pastor, "Pastor, I've just come inside. And what I think is one of your children is outside, and there's a mob surrounding that child that looks really, really ugly." You know the punchline, right? The pastor is not going to ask me, "Well, start. What do you want me to do?" The question, "Start. What do you want me to do?" is a question of the head and the flesh. So when the most heart-rending situation, the most life, the greatest opportunity for giving life is presented, which I did then and I'm doing now, is met with the question, "Well, start. What can I do?" It is a near perfect indication that the head and the flesh are alive and well, and the heart is 6 feet under. And all hope is with the heart. Without love, it is nothing. Without heart, it is nothing. And it's much worse than that. Without heart, it's head and flesh. And head and flesh are addictive creatures. And all they know is getting their fix, and anything that gets in the way is fair game. It's the most horrifying question. It's on my mind because a swarm of enormously promising students from my judgment, they're an international exchange program, maybe from all over the world, but I judge Africa being one of the major sources, came and spoke to me today, maybe 4 hours, 4 o'clock this afternoon, when I was moving toward unconsciousness due to the hunger strike and the heat. But their presence enlivened me, and we had a wonderful exchange for half an hour. Tremendous indication they still had hearts. But at the end, one of the most hopeful girls said, "Start, we're going back to our countries today or tomorrow. What can we do to help?" And the example I gave her was, "Okay, this is an extremely important question that you ask. But probably not for the reason that you think." I had spent significant time talking about the science and the technology and the time frames that we have over and over and over again, because they asked over and over and over again. They wanted to get it. She wanted to get it. But at the end, "Start, how can we help?" This group was, I'm not sure, let's see, maybe 16, 17, maybe 18. Really an extremely encouraging group. And I said to her, "We're in an extreme situation, so I'm going to give you an extreme situation to try and illustrate a point. If, God forbid, you were walking on the street with a dear friend, and that dear friend was hit by a car, would you be asking passersby, 'What can I do to help?'" Oh, she instantly got it. And therefore, it instantly moved things toward her heart, out of her head, and toward her heart. She got it. I got it. the head and the flesh when it comes to problems. Central to their way of being is externalizing problems and limiting the number of problems that they face. An addict does this, and the head and the flesh are addictive creatures. They want to deny, keep outside everything that they can that would distract from their intoxications, their pleasures. The heart is the exact opposite. Don't tell me you don't have any answers. I can't accept not having answers. I can't accept having a direction for achieving this. And figuratively, I mean, we're just not going to end this conversation. We're not going to end this relationship. I'm not going to stop until I get an answer in time. That's what the heart does. Everything in the future of every young person in your life, including yourselves, depends upon moving this impending climate genocide into the heart exactly the same way it would already be in our heart if we could see that it was being done by the Iranians, or by the Russians, or by the Chinese, or by green men in spaceships. Everything depends upon moving it into the heart. And the heart only knows such a problem as its own problem. Get out of my way. I'm going to stand in harm's way for my child with that mob that you tell me about. I am going to get help for my friend that was just hit by a car. If you can help, great. Otherwise, get out of my way now. Everything depends upon moving this issue into the heart. Everything. The heart is the highest form of human intelligence. It's the highest form of human motivation. It is the ultimate mobilizer of every ounce of strength and every neuron in our brains. Everything else is straightening the deck chairs on the Titanic.